It's time to enter the drone zone with me, James Drone, aka Pure Ambient Drone. So hit that subscribe button, tap that bell, and get ready to synth on.
Hey there, synth drones. We're back with episode number 61 of Midnight Synthesizer Talk with me, James Drone, the voice of synthesizers. And if you haven't already done so, hit that subscribe button, tap that bell to keep up with all of my synth adventures. So tonight I want to talk about regrets that I have made with synthesizers. And I think that if you do this long enough, you're going to find that you'll have regrets if you haven't already found out that regrets come. And I think one of the things that I kind of regret is not leaving well enough alone in the studio. I have gone through so many changes, and when I find something, and this is so bad of me, when I find something that works really great, my brain starts to kick in and says, hey, if this is great, then maybe the next level will be fantastic. And then I start making decisions that aren't always the best for me or my production flow. And so I have done that on more than one of occasions. And I think it's a regret that a lot of people have. They find a workflow, they find a sound, they find a method that works for them. And it doesn't have to be just with synthesizers. It could be with anything in life. And then they tinker with it and they try to perfect it and make it better, not realizing that most things that are working for us are perfect in their own way, okay? And also not realizing that you're never going to reach a level of perfection in anything that you do, that there has to be a place where we eventually say, hey, this is enough, this works, and we need to move forward on other things that are not working for us. So, you know, I look back into the archives of my videos here on YouTube, and my earlier videos, my earliest, show me doing live jams. And the workflow was laid out on some tables with modules. And I really enjoyed the modules because you could stack them and then you could have like three or four in a rack and you could sit there and tweak them and do all the things that you wanted to do. The problem was is I started adding more MIDI keyboards per module, and then those little MIDI keyboards started filling up on the tables. And then next thing I thought is, hey, why not just buy keyboards and you know, buy some with sequencers and arpeggiators already built into them, and you won't have to have a keyboard. I mean, just this stuff just goes through your head, and you start thinking about how you can tweak stuff. And before you know it, you end up in a room that's pretty much filled up with keyboards instead of modules. And I do miss the modules a lot, and I still have some. I don't think they're well. Yeah, they are. I still have a few, and I really enjoy modules because they don't take up a whole lot of space. And speaking of which, I am going to be looking into getting the Pro 800 right now as I speak. That is a definite module that I want to invest in from Behringer, the Pro 800. I'm very interested in that. And I'm kind of glad that they actually made that into a module because I'm like totally out of space over here. I think I've got room for maybe one more synthesizer, and I haven't made up my mind, keyboard size. I haven't made up my mind what that's going to be, but it's probably going to be the UBX-A more than likely. I'm really thinking about getting that. In fact, you know, I'm set on getting that right now. But the mistakes that I have made, you know, it's like, okay, so a synthesizer is working for me. Here's another one. A synthesizer is working for me. And then I look at what I can do to make that synthesizer even better, like maybe upgrading it and then polishing it up. And then I go in and I spend all my time trying to figure out what I can do to make the synthesizer even bigger and better, not realizing that I've been working with this synthesizer and it's been working for me just the way it is, fine. It's been working fine, just the way it is. But then I start to get in and I start tweaking things and I spend hours and hours and hours and then I exhaust myself. And, you know, tweaking and playing around with your synthesizers, that's all good. That's all fun and that's all necessary. But it can be counterproductive in some ways if all you do is try to tweak your equipment. So I'm not saying that we shouldn't better our equipment. I'm not saying that we shouldn't work on our equipment or practice with it. What I'm saying is that we shouldn't spend hours and hours and hours obsessed over the equipment and then shopping online for like expansion cards and all of that stuff or cases or things that we just don't really need to produce what we're trying to produce with that synthesizer. That's all I'm saying. Other regrets is not keeping an eye on things the way I should, letting things slip through the cracks, if you will, rushing through projects and then having to go back and then fix everything that I wasn't paying attention to, or losing valuable information. So I'll give you an example of what I mean by that. So one of my albums, or maybe even two of them, I got some new equipment that I had to feed all the synthesizers through. Okay, it was a Neve DI, and it sounded really good. But in order to use it, I had to bounce all my tracks through it. And when I did that, I wasn't labeling which instruments that I was using. And I just wanted to get a project done because, well, I had a time limit on it. And so I just kind of rushed through it. And I could have took a few extra more seconds to label everything that I was doing and which synthesizers I was using. Because here's what I'm getting at. When I go back through my project now that I did, I say, wow, I really like what that synth is doing, and man, I don't even know which synth I use now, because I was bouncing stuff without labeling the tracks, what synth I was using on them. Today, I label every single track that I lay into music. So if I have 4, 5, 6, 7, or just one track for a composition, it will be labeled as to what synthesizer I used. I don't go as far as labeling the preset because I always tweak presets anyway, and I never want to use another preset again after I used it, just for uniqueness. So I don't really care about that so much, but I like to go back and listen to my music and know what I used on that track. And so in the past, I've rushed through things and haven't done that. And so, yeah, a little bit of sloppiness is what I guess I'm getting at. I think the other thing is rebuying synthesizers is another regret. Buying synthesizers that I've already had and let go for one particular reason or another, only to buy it again and then rediscover the reason why I got rid of it in the first place. So repeating the same mistake over and over again, buying the same synthesizer and then losing money doing it, because you can lose money. You can own a synth and then sell a synth and then regret it, go back and buy it, and then realize, wait a minute, I really didn't want this, and then sell it again and then take a loss. It is kind of funny with me. When I don't want a synthesizer, it seems like it's really cheap on the used market, right? But then when I suddenly am looking for that synthesizer, suddenly the prices of the used synth that I want goes up. I mean, it's just got to be a coincidence. I just don't know. I mean, I'm trying to be funny here, but it does seem like that happens a lot to me. I guess the other thing is that I became a shop. I became a shop maniac, a shopping maniac. What's the word am I looking for? I just became addicted to shopping for synthesizers. It's really easy to be profitable in this business and then want to spend money on the craft that's making you money. Does that make sense? And so when you get a little bit of extra cash, what you want to do is you want to go shopping with it, right? And the one thing that I love the most is synthesizers. And so it's really tempting just to get on the internet and start shopping for synthesizers, especially when a lot of companies offer two-day shipping on a synthesizer. I mean, you can order today and get in a few days what you ordered, and it's exciting. But I think the biggest regret that I've ever made to this date, and I fixed it right away. I ordered a Korg Kronos just shy of $4,000. And immediately when it arrived, I literally had a sick feeling to my stomach. I just knew that this was a mistake. I shouldn't have done it. I don't know why I did it, but I was talking with people about the Korg Kronos and gas started. And so I bought it. And then, you know what? I had buyer's remorse immediately when it showed up. It was a big monster 88 version keyboard. Oh, my gosh. I let it go. I sent it right back. And luckily, the company had a return policy, and they didn't charge me anything for returning it. Really great. So that was probably one of my biggest mistakes, if not my biggest, in purchasing a synthesizer, at least. So that's all I have for you tonight on Midnight Synthesizer Talk. What is your biggest mistake, your biggest regrets? Share it with us in the comments below. And until next time, hit that subscribe button, tap that bell, and keep calm and synth on.